AD.
Yeah.
So we are live.
Hello, I'm Roma Downey.
And I'm Mark Burnett, otherwise known as Roma's husband.
And welcome to Google Plus Hangout. It's our very first time doing this, so we really hope that it goes well. We're here to talk with you and share with you about our latest beautiful movie, Son of God, which is currently playing in over 3,000 theaters across the country. And we are delighted that we have here Kathie Lee Gifford. Kathie Lee is speaking directly to us from her home in Connecticut. Are you there, Kathie Lee?
I'm here, Roma. Hi, Mark, and I'm delighted. Not only do I love and respect the two of you so much, but I think you're incredibly brave to make this movie and then to ask me to host this hangout on Google when I'm the least technologically advanced human being on the planet. So let's all say a little prayer that I can get my act together. I want to thank you all for this movie. You all sent it to me about 2 months ago, and I fell in love with it, of course. You'd been on my show with Hoda promoting the Bible series, so I was already familiar with the Jesus section of the Bible series, and fell in love, of course, with Diogo Morgado, who just did such an extraordinary job playing the very, very difficult role of Jesus. And then when I found out that my old pal Eduardo Verastegui had voiced the Jesus in the Spanish version, I said, who else do I love that's a member of my family that's in this movie, and I didn't even know it. So I just want to thank you all. I'm hearing from so many people from all walks of life and many different faiths how much this is touching them, you guys, and I know that was your full intention from the very beginning. We'll talk about that in just a moment, but let's introduce everybody, okay? First of all, I want to tell everybody before I do that there are ways that you at home or wherever you are can submit your questions via the Google Plus Q&A app if you're in the Google Hangout. You can also use hashtag Son of God being all one word, in your social media posts so we can see your questions and your comments, and hopefully we'll get to them. I have a feeling we're going to wish we had much more than just 1 hour tonight, because awful lot of controversy and discussion about this movie all over the country. Okay, so on our Hangout tonight we have, say hello to Diogo Morgado, who plays Jesus. Where are you, Diogo? There you
I'm
are.
I'm here. Next to Eduardo. You guys see me?
Yeah,
Am I on?
You're just as gorgeous as you were last week when you were sitting in this room with me.
No.
And next to him is Eduardo Verastegui, who voices, as I said, Jesus in the Spanish version. Hello, my friend.
Delighted to be here with Diogo. And
pleasure.
Such a pleasure. Really grateful for this beautiful opportunity that Google is giving us to share the experience of Son of God with everyone that is right there watching
us. Well, it's amazing, isn't it, when you think about the technology involved here. You can reach billions. It's just extraordinary.
It's impressive.
So let's get started. I want to tell everybody that this movie has literally taken the world by storm. Son of God was released just last Friday. It has amazed cynical Hollywood, which we knew it would, $26 million box office on the opening weekend, which was the highest opening for a faith film ever, other than The Passion of the Christ. 90% positive response and a 5-star rating on Post-Track. And number one fan-rated film on Fandango, which the one I love, because that's the people speaking. You know, those are the people that went to see it, paid their hard-earned money to go see it because they knew they were going to get a blessing. And an A-minus rating on CinemaScore, which is huge. So obviously the first question, after saying congratulations, you all, is it comes from faith.com, and that's for you, Roma and Mark. Are you at all surprised by the box office success of the movie?
Well, we are just, you know, we're just delighted that so many people's lives are being touched by the movie. Mark and I have been working on this film. It's been a passion project for us, a labor of love, right, born out of our own faith journey, to be able to do what we love to do, to be able to do what we believe, and to do it together has been a blessing for us. And we've been just so encouraged this week as we've heard the numbers come in, but more importantly, as we've started reading the notes and the emails and the tweets, mm-hmm, and seeing how the movie is touching hearts and opening hearts.
Mark, you have had nothing but success in this industry, but this has to be a whole different kind of successful feeling for you. It's of a spiritual nature this time around.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've obviously had a lot of fun with between Touched by an Angel and The Voice and Survivor and Shark Tank. Our careers, we've been very blessed. But there's nothing like this. I mean, we'll probably never, ever again in our lives work on anything like this. And so it's been a wonderful, wonderful experience. And as Roma said, the hundreds of emails coming in hourly,
yes,
of people's experiences, they're saying it's not a movie. It's an experience. And,
exactly.
And that's very important.
Yes, we hosted, and as many, many people did, I loved how the faith-based community got so involved and asked different individuals around the country to host screenings of the film in advance of it being released, so that churches and individuals of means would be able to buy out whole theaters and just advance in advance of the movie even being opening officially on a Friday. I know there were theaters all over the country on Thursday night that had been bought out by people who just wanted people that couldn't afford a ticket to be able to come and see this magnificent movie.
No, it's been just beautiful. Kathie Lee, as you know, Jesus hasn't been on the big screen for a decade. And, you know, we just know there's a whole generation just so eager to see his life played out in a cinematic presentation in this way. I think more than anything, I've heard from moms who have been just so grateful to have a movie that they can take their kids to, and it's been a great conversation starter afterwards. So we're very encouraged. You know, we've all worked very hard, and anything, it takes a team. We've had a great team.
Yes.
We've worked hard. Mark and I have been out on the road, and we're just so grateful to all the people who've stepped up to help, and through this movie that we can spread the word and spread the love.
Well, I think you sensed as you traveled the country that everybody had an eagerness in their heart to help you with this, because the world out there is hungry for hope, hungry for hope. And I know the biggest not problem, but situation you had going into filming was you had not cast your Jesus yet, right? And then along comes a tape of a guy named Diogo Morgado. Tell us, maybe I should go to you, Diogo, because you said when you got this, well, tell us about it, when you got the call to audition for the role of Jesus.
First of all, I mean, it's a pleasure to be here. It's really a privilege, you know, to share this. For me, it's the best story of love ever. Mm-hmm. Talking about the whole process, it was something unique, because the first time I got this the call saying that somebody was interested in me reading for the role of Jesus, I was like, there's no way I can do this. There's no way I can be even scratching the surface of something so big. So I was like, okay, the only thing I can really do is just share what I think Jesus is for me, you know, and what I believe Jesus is for me and my relationship with him. So I was just like, you know, out of fun experiment or just sharing my idea of Jesus, I did it, but never believing that I would be, you know, picked up. And even later on, when Mark and Rome asked me to meet them in their home, I went there just with this idea that I would be having this 15-20 minute conversation, you know.
Yes.
And that would be it. And it turned out to be like a 2-hour conversation. And was not only about the project, but about the whole thing, about this that we're talking about the world is craving for something like this, you know, and people are needing for some light. So yeah, we would talk about this whole thing about 2 hours. And when I left, I was like, I don't know exactly who they are. I don't know exactly what they're gonna do, but I just want to be part of this, regardless of the part.
Did they not know at the time they asked you to audition that you already shared their same faith? You already had a relationship with Jesus?
I don't remember exactly what was our conversation. I know this. I know there was whatever we talked with love and sharing love. Mm-hmm. And I don't know exactly the words because, you know, I was so out of my mind at the time. And it was like almost like 2 years and something
ago. Yeah.
So I don't remember exactly, but what I felt that for them the priority was to find
the not only the right persons, but the right all the right elements to tell the story as the best as possible and as accurate as possible. You know, I understand for little details, like for instance, Roma used to say this joke about people getting out of the washing machine looking like all sharp and clean, you know, and that they wanted something real, something that people would see it on screen and identify with and see it with a real perspective, you know, like the whole life of Jesus was 50 years ago, 10 years from the Passion, but 50 years ago from the whole life of Jesus. So I realized that they were not only committed personally, but they were extremely, extremely committed as professionals and try to make this a story that will last long after we're all gone.
The authenticity is what they were after.
Yes.
And Eduardo, you've been very open about your Christian faith for many, many years. Yeah, I fell in love with you when the movie Bella came out, and it had such a beautiful, beautiful story of faith. And affirming the value of life as in God's eyes, that every life is precious. And so when you got the call to voice Jesus for the Spanish version, what was your first reaction?
Well, Kathy, first of all, I was already a big fan of Roma and Mark and the Bible series, and we became very good friends. And after we became very good friends, because they were helping us in another project, 2 months later, after this friendship, I was having dinner with Mark and Roma, and you know, we were talking about other things, and then out of the blue, they invited me to work in this production in dubbing the movie in Spanish, and then told me, do you want to be Jesus in Spanish? And I was like,
I know that you freaked out, right?
I freaked out because, first of all, this is the love of my life. I mean, this is the center of my life. This is who I live for. This is, I mean, I'm talking about, you know, like how can I? I said yes, of course, you know. But then when I left, I freaked out. I said, well, maybe I'm too prideful to say yes. How in the world I can be the voice of Jesus? You know, no matter how great I would do it, I would be sure to compare to who he is. You know, he's God. He's the Son of God.
How can you be worthy?
Exactly. I felt not worthy, and I felt like I don't know if I answer right by saying yes, and so it was. Fighting within myself internally, like what should I do, but I give my word, and I start praying and say, please give us the wisdom to do this right, because you deserve the best, and please help us to understand who the actors will be to play the you know, all the roles and the movie in Spanish. And then 2 months later, I was on the set in this little room. I felt like I was in a cloister monastery, you know, 7 days in a dark room.
It's a whole other
freaking
thing.
Freaking out,
right?
Very nervous, you know, and until one day just closed my eyes and said, Lord, this is your movie. I don't want people to hear me. I want them to hear you. So please allow your voice to shine and to come through the voice of this donkey.
Well,
but you know what?
Some donkey.
Who helped me a lot. Diego, I was telling just before the interview that when I saw him in the monitor, I didn't see him. You know, he's such an amazing actor. I saw Jesus, and I can only imagine how hard. I mean, I was shaking just by being the voice of Jesus. I can only imagine being in his you know, position, doing the whole interpretation of Jesus. He helped my word to be easier, because I was so touched and so moved by him, to the point that I started crying in scenes that I didn't supposed to cry. The director was telling me, Eduardo, you don't cry here. I know, but I'm so moved, I'm so touched, I want to cry. I know, but you don't cry. You have to imitate in every single thing that he already chose. I know, I'm so sorry, I'm just so touched.
You're supposed to be looping him.
I know, but every single time he was talking, I was like, I felt like Jesus was talking to me at that moment. I was like,
that's the power.
Beautiful. Powerful. I'm very thankful to Mark and Roma and for you, brother, because you did an amazing work.
Thank
and
you,
God bless you,
God bless
all,
you.
Ever, you know. And
well, don't
Mark,
go away, you guys. Don't go away.
No. We're just warming up.
We're going to start crying again right now.
Okay. Let's see if we can get another hour on this this Google Hangout. All right. Projectinspired.com would like to ask Mark and Roma, what measures did you use to approach the biblical accuracy in the making of Son of God? Great question.
Yeah, we knew that bringing our Gospels to the big screen came with a big responsibility, and one that we took very seriously. And we worked with a great number of experts and scholars and theologians along the way to make sure that we brought the story accurately to the screen. And then we also worked with faith leaders across mm-hmm. our nation, across denominations, I'm so grateful for the support and the endorsements of many of the faith leaders out there. And it's been a really, it was a slow process to get these scripts done, to send them out for accuracy, but it was a worthwhile one, and I think that the response to the film has been shows that was all, it was important to do it right. This movie will be seen for generations to come. This movie will go out and touch people whose names we may never know, in places we may never visit, in lives will be impacted for eternity, and it's such a blessing.
Well, exactly. You won't know someday until perhaps heaven itself, people will come up and say, thank you so much. I went to see Son of God that weekend, and it touched my heart, and it changed my life, and transformed me forever. That's exactly what happened to me as a 12-year-old little girl, so I know the power of film. I went to see a movie called The Restless Ones that the Billy Graham Organization had put out. First time I'd ever seen a faith movie, and you guys go to all the trouble of making it excellent and authentic and all those things, but ultimately it's the power of the Holy Spirit that touches a person's heart. You just made room for all of that to happen. And when God touches a human heart and says, I love you and I want to make something beautiful out of your life, you've just given the vehicle for that to happen. And that's why this is so powerful and why you're hearing from people all over the country. And I'm sure you're going to release it, as you said, and it's in Korean, it's in Spanish now, and I'm sure you have plans to take it all over the world, don't you?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we feel pretty sure over the next 30 or 40 years, not only will this movie be a regular annual TV event,
yes,
but we expect this to be in 100 countries, 100 languages, and we're already discussing with people how to do that.
And then you're also preparing for your next series, which will be on my network, AD. So it all continues. And I guess The Voice is going to have to do without you for a little while, Mark. You got some good people taking care of it, I guess. We have a question from one of our viewers. Carol Hampton on Google+ asks, in this movie, the guy that plays Jesus, which is, of course, Diogo, seems so genuine. How did he come about being cast in this role of a lifetime? You basically, Diogo kind of answered that.
Yeah, well, we were just a few weeks away from beginning principal photography, and we still had not found Diogo. We knew that this was going to be the most important piece of casting that we would do, that maybe we would ever do. And so we prayed. We put it out there in prayer. I sent out an email to my prayer group and to our church and to our community at large with the headline saying, looking for Jesus.
And aren't we all?
And remember that prayer, honestly, it's maybe the first time that the Holy Spirit really inspired a piece of casting, but through a series of extraordinary coincidences, suffice to say that Diogo was introduced to us, and we reached out immediately to meet with him. We thought that he was in Portugal. His team thought that we were in London. Turns out we were all in Los Angeles. And we asked that he would come over for the meeting that he's already described. And we the minute we saw him, we knew, that he was the one. And his performance, of course, is just extraordinary. I can't imagine anybody else in that role now.
I totally agree. And Diogo, I must say that I loved especially seeing the Jesus you portrayed as one loving on children, waving to people, smiling. That time in Palestine was a dangerous, dangerous time, and people were just struggling to survive on a daily basis. You wouldn't expect to see a happy person walking through the wilderness, and yet you portrayed him as so loving, and I know that was on purpose.
Exactly, it was not. I kept, all the time I kept thinking of, because we have this. We know that Jesus is love, so it's like, okay, so how can we how can we spread that love? How can we share that love? You know, and sometimes I realize, and you know, it's so easy that we sometimes we tend to forget, we tend to complicate a lot, we tend to think we have this process to get there, and sometimes it's just a smiling or a touch or saying I love you, you know. And so yeah, with the help of and with the support of especially Roma, she was relentless because Mark had all this other
little,
shows going on at the same time, and he was like he wanted to be there all the time, and he was like with the voice and everything. but Roma, especially Roma, and as an actress and as a producer, and she knew exactly what I was struggling and what I was dealing with, and she was so wise and so kind to know exactly when to say what she said. And certain things. And I remember that one of the scenes, for instance, I never told this before, one of the scenes is when Jesus gets to Jerusalem on the donkey. Mm-hmm. And I remember that she reached me out, and I was kind of tense because, you know, it's also a political scene. It's, you know, because Jesus knew what he was doing. He knew that the prophecy said that the Messiah would be coming on a donkey. So he knew exactly what he was doing. He was announcing himself as the Savior, as the Messiah. So it was risky. And I was so aware of that political side that I kind of forgot about the other side. And she reached out to me and said, like, don't forget to smile. She said, just light up the world. You know, and I was like, yes, exactly. Never forget to spread the love. To share the love, you know. So it was a collaborative thing. It was not just me. It was, I mean, there were certain choices that I, you know, that happened through me. But we were all together as a family. And this is not a cliche to say. When you're shooting in Morocco for 4 months, the only thing you really have to rely on, you have to rely on what you believe and on each other. You know, we have to support ourselves. And they were relentless on that. So I'm really, really grateful for every single second and for, you know, come on, everything that is happening right now.
Yeah, and it must be overwhelming. We've been joined by Erwin McManus. Hi, Erwin. He's the lead pastor at MOSAIC Church out in Los Angeles, which is considered one of the most extraordinary churches in America today. I have a friend, actually, Erwin, staying at my house right now who's a member of your church. She wants me to say hello to you.
Well, that's great. It's great to be here with you guys.
He's just said amazing things. You think the imagination is what sets us apart from all of other life on the planet. And it's absolutely when we're at our most godlike, when we're using our imagination. Did I get that sort of right?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, I think that in the same way that bees create hives and ants create colonies, human beings create futures. We materialize the invisible. We have dreams, ideas, visions, imagination. If we find the courage and the resolution and resolve, we actually begin to create that imagination and turn it into reality. That's what I love about Mark and Roma.
Yes.
I mean, they just dream amazing dreams and then find the courage and discipline and faith to execute those dreams into reality.
What are you hearing from people in your church? I know you're on a book tour, so you're probably traveling around a little bit. I think you're in Florida right now, right?
I am right now.
What are you hearing from people that whose their lives have been touched by this?
Well, what I love is that, you know, I grew up Roman Catholic. I went to Mass every few years. And so really my spiritual narrative was Ben-Hur, the robe, the Ten Commandments. Everything I knew about God or about Jesus, I experienced and learned from a film. And Charlie Brown taught me more about Jesus than the Bible ever did.
Oh, and from the book of Luke and the little Christmas special, I loved it.
That's right. That's the first time I ever heard the Bible. And every year I would watch that just to hear that small portion of the scriptures.
Because Charles Schultz, the creator of Peanuts, was a devout Christian man. And he was such a big deal, he could fight for that and get it, which was so awesome at the time. You're right.
That's right. What people don't realize is that across America, there are people who have no idea how to access a Bible. They don't have any idea how to connect to who Jesus is. They're terrified about walking into a church. Maybe they've had a really bad experience in the past in the church. And what Mark and Roma have done through the Son of God is they have made Jesus accessible to people where the movie theater is their church. And the film is their sermon. And they're getting connected to Jesus for the first time in their lives.
Mark and Roma, is that what you're hearing basically from other people? Have you had, tell us, give us one example of a life transformed so we can put a face on it, so to speak.
Well, we had a letter today from a mother of a teenage son, and I guess she had been trying on a weekly basis to get the boy to, you know, to go to church or to read scripture, and he had been sort of shut off to the possibility of that in his life. And but he did agree to go to the film with her, and after the movie, he grace opened his heart in such a way that he wept at the movie, and he wept in the car, and he wept all the way home, and he in that opening of his heart, he allowed himself to receive. So he opened up, and he's they went back and started reading scripture immediately. She wanted to anchor it in something for him, and he's agreed to at least explore church this weekend. So that was like one story of one family, of one boy's life transformed through the loving, redemptive message of Jesus. And I think when you said, Kathie, the possibility that grace can move through this, you know, we're very good friends with Pastor Rick Warren, and he said to us a number of years ago that the most dangerous prayer you could pray would be, use me, to use me. And that's something that we have done. This project began with prayer for us together on the Bible series, and we have continued to pray that we would draw the right people to us. You know, God doesn't always call the qualified, but he qualifies the called. Yes. And we came at this with true hearts of wanting to be able to share this experience. And I think when everybody's, you know, came together, that the sum of the parts is greater, and that we're seeing that the film is able to maybe reach the lost and bring them home. That, I think, is spectacular.
Mark, you were that person at one time in your life that didn't have an understanding of a personal walk with the living God. I didn't realize that you were a man of faith until just a few years ago, and I figured once you got with Roma, it was just a matter of time. But would you mind sharing for everybody how you came to? I mean, we all know you as this unbelievably successful producer on television, probably the first billion-dollar producer ever in that industry. But I know you now as a man that looks at that and says, so what? What am I going to do next for the Lord? How in the world did that happen?
Well, yeah, just growing up, like probably many people, I grew up always with a Bible in their house, and Scottish Catholic dad, Scottish Presbyterian mom, but never really realized there was a difference between the two, went to both churches. Mm-hmm. But I always thought the Bible was kind of a rule book, that if you stepped left or right of God's rules, a lightning bolt was going to hit you and kill you. And what I've realized in the last several years, yeah, there obviously are rules, but it's actually a love story. Mm-hmm. And so while this movie is incredibly tense and dramatic and full of anguish at times, it's also in the middle of that political drama, that epic movie, there is this personal love story. And we're seeing it really happen. And another story for you, 2 weeks ago, a woman of an Eastern religion, an Asian woman, had seen the Son of God, a preview of the movie, and she came to us afterwards and said the following: you know, Mark and Roma, I always thought this was a Western myth, this story of Jesus. However, having seen Son of God, I want to find out more about this Jesus. I need to find out more. And it was amazing to us, the power that a movie, as Erwin said, and we know Erwin very, very well. He's been in our home many, many times. We're very close friends. And Erwin's a great guide and a great encourager to us. And what he said is true. While a movie cannot be, we're not pastors. We're not qualified to teach a movie. But we're qualified to emotionally connect with people and help them seek more. And it's, you know, through the amazing actor portrayals of Roma and Diogo, and Eduardo lending his voice for the Spanish version. This is very important. By the way, Kathie, there were 200 theaters showing the Spanish version last weekend. As of this morning, that's risen to 353 theaters showing the movie in Spanish.
And how many in Korean? We don't want to leave our Korean friends out.
No. We actually, as you know, stepped up and made a Korean subtitle version. There's that 20 theaters in Korean showing that. There's three theaters in LA which have committed to the Korean version for 3 weeks. That's absolutely amazing and a great feeling for us to have pushed out that in several languages.
Erwin, I just came back from L.A. at the Oscars, and of course they just gave out all their huge awards and everything. It's always quite an experience. But I sense now when I'm in Los Angeles, it's almost like a harvest time now. All of a sudden, I mean, when I was out there as a young actress starting out, it was hard to find a good church. Now, and young people are in droves coming to Reality Church, your church, some of the other churches. It's just, are you seeing that as well? It's like there's a harvest happening with young people.
Absolutely. It's happening everywhere, and it just astonishes me to see thousands and thousands and thousands of people in their 20s just crowding into Mosaic. The average age of our community is probably 25, 26 years old, and they're, you know, sharp and hip and beautiful and handsome and desperately searching for meaning in their life.
That's what it is.
Looking to connect to someone. Probably, I would guess, 10 to 20% of the people who come to Mosaic are atheists. About 50% are Asians from Buddhist backgrounds, Hindu backgrounds. The whole world is searching for something that makes sense of their life. And this is a perfect moment for Jesus. And I have to tell you, there couldn't be a better moment for God to raise up someone like Mark and Roma, who brings so much optimism and hope and character and integrity and kindness and compassion. Because if the producers of this film did not emulate the character of the Jesus in the film, no one would buy into it.
I agree.
And I have to tell you, the power of this film is rooted in the power of the creators of this film.
I
just want to tell you, we should be thankful to God for these two people in the moment they've stepped up in history. I think Jesus is absolutely having a heyday and allowing the world to come to him through this beautiful work of art.
I totally agree, and we have a question. I keep wanting to just talk to y'all, but I don't want to hog it all. Alicia Silva from Google Plus asks, I guess this is for you, Mark and Roma, was Hans Zimmer your first choice for a musical composer? He did a glorious job.
Beautiful. Yes, absolutely. Hans was our first choice and only choice, actually, and it was a matter of going and sitting down with him, and Hans tells a funny story that he said, "How do you say no to Mark Burnett when you really want something?" And Hans knows, I really, really wanted Hans. I remember another thing happened. Roma was with myself and Hans, and Roma was explaining how it was very important to have a female voice, and said to Hans, "Can we find someone like Lisa Gerrard that you worked with on Gladiator?" He said, "Roma, why would we find someone like Lisa Gerrard where we can get Lisa Gerrard? I'm going to call her right now." And he put us on the phone with Lisa, and it turns out Lisa Gerrard is also Christian and was delighted, even though she's on a world tour, to find time in studios all over the world to lend her voice.
Yeah.
Which has become now iconic in this soundtrack.
And her voice is so haunting, and the melodies are so beautiful. You know, in any film, the music comes in. It's like casting another character.
Yes, it is. It's so important.
And this music it just elevates you. I listen to it in the car. It's like a meditation. There's such beauty to it. Hans Zimmer, Lorne Balfe, Lisa Gerrard, they created a beautiful score for this film.
And CeeLo Green sings at the end, "Mary, Did You Know?" which is just fantastic. So, and this soundtrack album is a CD is available, as well as another little devotional book that you all did. Tell us about the book. I don't have the name of it right here. What's the name of it?
Yeah, we have the soundtrack album, and then there was also created an inspired by album that has some beautiful music Francesca Battistelli did a beautiful original song called Son of God, which is just lovely and haunting and evocative, and was inspired by the film. The songwriter saw the movie one day and went and wrote this original song after. So the project is creating lots of beauty, lots of amazing, inspirational.
There's a book.
Yeah, there's a music tour coming. It's just different ways to touch people, different ways to bring the message home, you know.
Mm-hmm. And Kathie, that's what we feel we need to do. We've used television, we've used film, and now starting March 20th, there is a Son of God music tour through Warner Brothers, which is going to be in 20 cities. So all different ways to reach people.
Yes. Well, which is one of the commandments I believe the Lord left us with before he ascended, wasn't it? Go into all worlds and proclaim.
Yeah, absolutely.
But, you know, am I wrong about that, Erwin?
This is what we know how to do. Erwin has created a beautiful book called The Artisan Soul, which Erwin I've just started, and I'm absolutely loving it. But it's like exploring that this creativity is our gift from God, and that each of us, you know, we do what we can. You know, this is what we know how to do. We were all commissioned to spread the word, to spread the gospel, and this was the way that Mark and I knew how to do that, which was to bring it to the screen in this way.
The other thing that I've been seeing is that so many people who've grown up, Erwin, in the, and I want to talk to Eduardo about this as well, grown up in the Catholic Church or grown up in the Hispanic community, so many people have been brokenhearted in their Catholic faith through some of the different things that have happened through the years. And yet what I'm sensing now is a new longing in Catholics and in Hispanic people to have what they feel like they lost for a long time, which is, again, that oneness with God. And this movie is, I know, touching an awful lot of my Catholic friends who are now saying, I want to go back to church.
Yeah.
Eduardo, are you seeing that?
I think it's like in any other church, you have always good people and bad people, like anywhere else, you know. We're not the exception, you know. And all I can say is, you know, all the Twitters and all the emails that I've been receiving from all my Latino community, which, by the way, I want to take advantage of this opportunity to thank them for helping and supporting this wonderful movie, because I heard that the 200 theaters where we show Son of God in Spanish were all packed. Mm-hmm. So thank you for the Latino community to support this movie. And I heard what Mark Burnett just said, that now this weekend we are double deep. It's going to be now close to 400 theaters all showing the Spanish version. So, and it's just amazing, all the emails and all the letters that I get till today, where they're going to Mass not only every Sunday but every day to receive
like
communion,
you do,
to receive Jesus. I go to Mass every day since
you
the last 10 years.
You took me to St. Patrick's.
Yes, when I'm in New York, I go to St. Patrick, but you know, there is nothing for me greater than just to have communion every day, and I'm very, very grateful to this wonderful Pope that we have, Francis, who is showing us a beautiful message of humility and simplicity and using our talents that God gave us to serve him and to serve others, especially the ones who are in most need. And I'm very grateful again to the Latino community, and they promised me that they're gonna go all gonna go again to see the theater. They're gonna see it again two times, because they want to make sure that Jesus is number one in the box office.
Yes, let's all believe for that. Absolutely. I had some other great. This one is from Believe.com. It's for Roma and Mark. Can you tell us, was there a particular moment on set where you felt that God was blessing this project? From the very beginning?
Yes, no question. And Diogo can echo this. But there was a moment in a scene where Nicodemus was curious about Jesus and snuck away in the evening, not wearing his robes from the Sanhedrin, just snuck down to have a conversation, find out, who is this Jesus? What is it about this guy? And he asked Jesus, firstly, he says to him, they say you can see the kingdom of God. And Diogo, as Jesus says to him, you also can see the kingdom of God. You have to be born again. And Nicodemus says, I don't get that. I'm already an adult. How can I be born again? And Jesus explains, born in spirit And he goes on, and by the way, it's a very still night in the Sahara Desert. No wind, nothing. And Diogo's line there, he goes on and says, the spirit is like the wind. At that moment, a sustained supernatural wind blew across the desert and stayed on the set. It blew Diogo's hair and his robes and the trees. It looks like we turned on 20 wind machines. We had wow. No wind machines. No.
Wow.
Real. Diogo can speak to that. He was there.
Yeah, and that's the take that it was used for the film. So people actually can see that on screen, and it's not like Mark was saying, it was no wind machine, it was nothing. For a moment, you can even see me getting out of, for a glance, getting out of the figure of Jesus, and just feel graceful and blessed by that moment, and then I got in and used that moment to continue the word of Jesus. So, but it was definitely one of my special favorite moments, because like I said, it was right before I start saying the word wind, and the wind comes in. It's really magical. It's wonderful.
Well, thank goodness, because a lesser actor would have gone, whoa, that's unbelievable. You would have completely gotten out of God.
It was like 2 or 3% of me that got like that. Actually, if you pay attention, there's like a
split second. I would watch it again more carefully.
There's like a split second that you can see my face lighting up like, I can't believe this is happening.
But that could also just be your relationship with your father. Like, oh, there you are, Father, just right on cue, you know, yes, that can work too.
Definitely. I mean, let me tell you, one of the most powerful moments that I realized, you know, that how and we keep saying that this story is about love, but let's not be general and specify. We need to be specific. How strong is this love? I mean, I'm a father. I have a 4-year-old kid. So and I every time he falls or he, you know, he hurts himself or anything, I just fly and just, you know, try to make him help him, or just to avoid anything bad to happen to him. So imagine the love of God when Jesus is on his knees saying, please, Father, take this cup away from me, mm-hmm. and God has to say, no, you have to do this because of them. For the love of them. So this is a love that we don't have the understanding. We don't have what it needs to understand this type of love. We're talking
agape.
That's
love.
Why. Exactly. So we're too small to understand this. You know, so we just need to feed out of that and be grateful for what we have and what he's giving to us, you know. And it was a process to digest this. So it's like, obviously it's easy to say that it's a love story, but it's a really, for me, it's the best story, the best love story ever because of this.
The ultimate love story, isn't it?
Exactly.
Erwin, if people are watching and they think we're all just a bunch of kooks, well, they'd be right on some level. We are a bunch of kooks.
A little bit.
But why are we the happiest kooks on the planet? Why are we the most joyful people in the world, in spite of whatever circumstances we might be going through? And how can people have that kind of peace and joy in their lives, which does pass all understanding? And it's available for everyone. In our remaining moments, you as our pastor tonight, Erwin, tell people how they can have that too.
Well, Kathie, I don't know if I've ever heard anybody more articulate about who Jesus is in the gospel than you. What a wonderful, wonderful surprise.
That's true.
You know, I'm an immigrant as well. I came here from El Salvador, and I learned English as my second language, and I know what it's like to be an outsider looking in. Mm-hmm. I know what it's like to feel like you don't know how to belong and how to connect. And even as a follower of Christ, I've never forgotten what it's like to be an outsider looking in. I was a philosophy student in college, and I was on a search for meaning and trying to make sense of life. I remember thinking that I already investigated Jesus and had rejected him, and reading every philosopher I could find, every form of religion. And it was really, in my life, a point of despair, going, either Jesus is real or there's nothing that's real. And what I loved about the story and the message of Jesus is that every other religion gave me a way that I could try to earn God's love. I could try to find freedom from my guilt and my shame. I could try to find enlightenment. But the difference with Jesus was not a structure or a strategy on how to get to God. It was this declaration that God has done everything to get to me. Yeah. And so instead of the arrow pointing up with the staircase of my effort and my work, it was really God coming down to me, stepping into human history, and just the possibility that the central narrative of all the universe is love, that God is driven by love, that God stepped into human history because of love. I remember once I was in the Middle East and someone asked me what the true gospel was, and I said, the true gospel is this. I once met a girl named Kim, and I fell in love, and I pursued her with my love and pursued her with my love until I thought my love had captured her, and I asked her to be my wife, but she did not say yes. So I pursued her even more until my love overwhelmed her and she became my wife. But because it was an issue of love, I did not send my brother and I did not send a friend. Because in issues of love, you must go yourself. Mm-hmm. And that's why God didn't send simply a prophet or an angel or some text. God came himself because in issues of love, you must go yourself. Mm-hmm. That's why Jesus came, because everything God is trying to say to us is an issue of love. The cross, his crucifixion, his death, his passion, was God's ultimate declaration of love. And when he rose from the dead, he didn't come back with wrath or vengeance or anger. He came back with nothing but kindness and compassion and grace. I love the fact that the story and message of Jesus, the life of Jesus, is the declaration from God that he loves us, he sees us, and he refuses to give up on us. And that's why I think we're crazy in love, because God has given us a love that we have not deserved, and that we cannot lose even when we blow it. I love my life, and I just want people to experience the kind of life that comes through the person of Jesus. No need to sell anything. No need to try to persuade anyone. We just need to be fully alive and let people come and experience the life that Jesus and Jesus alone brings.
And it's a simple thing. It's opening your heart and just asking him to come in, and he will. You don't have to join a club. You don't have to tell people how they can do that if they're listening to us today.
It's funny. You are so precise, and it's so good. I remember a friend of mine, Soledad O'Brien, came up to me one day, and she said, I feel like I'm running round and round a building, but no one will tell me how to get in. Uh-huh. And I told her, it's the opposite. You're the building, and God is running around and around the building waiting for you to let him in. She goes, that's a beautiful metaphor. What do I do? And I said, well, you could do what I did. I didn't know how to talk to God. I didn't know what prayer was. So I had a friend that just kind of guided me in a prayer. And for the first time in my life, I had a conversation with God that has not ended to this day. And the conversation is so simple. It's, God, I need you. I'm convinced that you love me. I don't get it, but I want to receive it. And so in that moment, I just simply said to God, God, I just want to turn from a life without you. Jesus, I believe you were crucified on my behalf, that you rose from the dead to give me life. I want to turn from a life that is separate from you. I want to turn from my sin, from myself, from my jealousy, from my pride, from my fear, from my guilt, and I'm going to give my life completely to you. And that's what I would just say. Look, all you need to do is stop running from God, turn around, and he'll crash right into you, because God has been chasing you with his love ever since. It's not difficult. It's not physics. It's not complex. Just open your life to Jesus and find out how easy it is to connect to the God who created you and loves you.
It's the very reason that they're actually watching us right at this very moment, is because God has orchestrated that very circumstance for such a time as this. Don't you think, Roma? Don't you think, Mark?
Yeah, absolutely. Erwin's so eloquent, too. It's so touching, those words. And we're just so grateful. We're so grateful to God.
See, I know my wife so well. My wife could cry right now. I know her so well.
Yeah. Kathie.
The other girl has seen this a few times, trust me.
True. Kathie, yes. I just want to say one quick thing.
Yes.
You know, the beauty of this movie as well, which is, I was very touched by one thing, that regardless of, you know, the belief system of everyone that is watching us, because, you know, some religion believe that Jesus is a prophet, some others believe that he was just a good person, believe that he's the Son of God and he is the center of my life, the love of our lives, but regardless of, of the beliefs of other people, and we need to agree to one thing, this man changed the world. We base time in him, before Christ, after Christ. And I have received so many letters from people, are atheists, agnostics, etc., that they love this epic movie and they were so touched and moved by him. So, last week, somebody asked me, so this film is just for people who believe in Christ? I said, this film is for everyone. For everyone who wants to see a movie about the number one leader
that impact the world like no one else ever, and come and see this this movie. This man not only changed the world, changed the hearts, changed the lives of millions of people, including our own lives. This is a man who changed time, calendar, culture. Just for that reason, you know what? You don't have to be a believer to enjoy this film. You just have to be a human.
He never went more than 100 miles in any direction from where he was born, and yet the entire world. I was in Israel about a year ago, and I had an experience where I was at Herodian, where Herod, the so-called king of the Jews, had a palace, and you could see the little village of Bethlehem just to the side there. And our teacher was saying when they found Herod's tomb there, it was in 6,000 different pieces because he was so hated by the people that when they found his tomb, they just destroyed it. And our friend threw down his hat and he goes, Herod, was it worth it? Would you do it all again? And in my heart, I'm thinking, what does it profit a man if he gained the whole world and lose his very soul? And all of a sudden, a wind came up as well. And I look over, and I saw about 40 Kenyan people singing praises to the real king of the Jews, the king of everybody. Then I looked over, and then there were Chinese people in groups there because they were seeking the real king. The real king. And that's the world, what the world can offer us is nothing compared to what Jesus offers us in the form of not just eternal life after our life is over, but life abundantly right now, right here, as we live on this earth, a Zoe kind of life, abundant life that's overflowing. And that's what I think Mark and Roma are so beautifully portraying every time. Not only do they share their faith, but stand up, not just deal with the critics, the people that come against them for whatever reasons. Most hurting people hurt people. That's what they do. That's how they express their pain. And Mark and Roma, I've watched you over and over be so kind and so tender and loving in spite of that sort of a reaction. And Diogo, you portrayed that kind of compassion that God asks us to have for all people, even if they betray us, even if they reject us. We can love because He first loved us. Okay. And I'm not here to preach because Erwin's already done it, but in our remaining minute, if each one of you would like to say one last thing, and I'll start with you, Erwin, if that's your real name.
Well, it's an alias, if you want to know, but that's okay. It's a different story. You know, what I would say is that one is if you're in L.A., we're on Hollywood Boulevard and La Brea. Mosaic is there, and people come from every religion and every background and every place. And we have so many atheists who come, and it's a great place for people to have a safe environment to process who God is and to discover how real Jesus is. But most of all, I just want to thank God for Mark and Roma. Amen. And for their film, Son of God. I want to thank all the people who are so sacrificial in putting it together. It's just a real gift for all of us to have them in our lives.
Well, thank you for joining us tonight, Erwin. And next time I'm in L.A., my daughter and my son and I are coming to see you, okay?
That'll be great. God bless you all.
God bless you. Diogo, what would you like to say?
I would just like to say that, like Eduardo was saying, just give yourself a chance. Roma says something that it's really beautiful, and I truly believe that when you're open, the light comes in. And we, every day, every single day, we turn on the news, and it's just so awful, and it's so ugly out there. We need to believe. We need to love, and we need to share that love, and we need to have hope. So buy a ticket and, you know, grab some popcorn, some Coca-Cola, and just be available. Yeah. To be open. That would be my word.
I guess you would say that same thing, right, Eduardo? Pretty much close to
As a filmmakers and as actors, you know, our hope is that when people come and see Son of God, they will leave the theater not only entertained, because as Mark and Roma said, more than a movie, this is an experience, it's a movement of love. I hope that they will leave wanting to love more, They will leave wanting to judge less. They will leave wanting to forgive more. They will leave wanting to be a better person, inspire, you know, wanting to change the world through the talents, with the talents that God gave them. And I'm very excited today because finally we just we met.
Yeah,
Yo and I.
Oh, you're kidding!
So imagine, yeah, I've been watching him like a thousand times. First of all, when I was dubbing the movie, but then I have watched the movie. I don't know how many times. I lost the number. You know. And finally today, this is an exclusive, Google exclusive, you know.
Oh, wow.
I met Jesus in person.
There's a romance happening. And he's just newly moved to Los Angeles, so you can take him and his family around, Eduardo, and show him.
You know, we're brothers now and forever.
This is just the beginning of a great relationship.
This is beautiful. Well, this is so awesome. Well, thanks both of you for being with us tonight.
Thank you, Kathie.
And of course, I want to end with Mark and Roman. Thank you guys for entrusting me with this hour. It's way past my bedtime, so if I made any mistakes, that's why. But my heart longed to just support you guys.
Love you. I just want to thank you for stepping in and doing this for us. You're such a good and dear friend to us and have been for many, many years. And I just want you to know how much we love you and value you. So thank you.
God bless you, sweet. Roma and I became friends when I did two episodes of Touched by an Angel many, many, many years ago. And you could see the light in you.
When we were children.
We were, yes, mere children. We don't want to talk about how many years ago. Mark, why don't you give us one more exhortation about why this film is should be seen by hurting people?
You know, this is a great experience. It's also a big film. I mean, this is not some little, inexpensive Christian film.
No.
This has got epic score from Hans Zimmer, as we discussed. The same special effects team that did Gladiator. It's an epic, big, sweeping film. And as the guy said, this is for everybody. And we know something happens when you see this film. I also can't explain it. You know, I have faith, so I'm not really looking for scientific explanations. It just is what it is. It just happens. And when you're in a room with 200 people watching this movie, it's an amazing energy in that room. And we've experienced it. We've seen the movie 500 times, and we still go and see it again. Something just happens. Go see it and get the experience for yourself.
And if you do know the Lord in a personal way and you do have that walk with Him that empowers you on a daily basis, don't feel like you shouldn't go to see it because you already know the story, in quotes. It's a tremendous opportunity to take those people with you that you've been praying for years, like the mom with her son. You know, use this as an opportunity. This is a vehicle where you don't have to do the talking. Let the story speak for itself. I was at St. Augustine who said, preach the gospel at all times, but whenever necessary, use words. You know, we're supposed to be out there living the gospel, but your movie shares the story of the greatest love affair ever possible. God's love for all He has created, every one of us. So thank you to all of you tonight. Roma and Mark, I'm so happy to see you finally home, cozy wozy in your beautiful home. Enjoy, rest up, Diogo. And, Eduardo, I'm so happy the two of you have met. Lord bless you both. You're always welcome here in our home in Connecticut. And I think we just lost Erwin because he's on a book tour. I know what that's like. So God bless everybody. Thank you all for joining us tonight.
Thank
we
you.
All came through a Google. What's it
Dios
called?
Dios los bendiga. Dios los bendiga.
Gracias,
bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Lord bless you all. Good night, everybody.
Good night.